Welcome to the LaRouche Connection. My name is Webster Tarpley, and today we're going to tackle a question that every American ought to be ashamed of, the current situation of Iraq. If you want a case study to show that American foreign policy will be morally and intellectually insane as long as we follow the script written by those lunatics in London, then look no further than Iraq. If you want a case study of what the one world supranational butchers at the United Nations have in store for the world, look no further. There are two issues involved: the Gulf War, which ended in the late winter of 1991, and then the economic embargo, which is still going on. Let's start with the embargo. 3.5 years after the end of the shooting war in the Gulf, the United Nations Security Council is still enforcing a near total economic embargo against Iraq. This embargo was reaffirmed most recently by the Perm 5 of the Security Council in May 1994. In that meeting, Russia, France, and China waffled, but the mad dogs from London and the striped pants gang from the State Department were able to obtain another indefinite extension of the embargo against Iraq. The pretexts included alleged Iraqi noncompliance with UN weapons inspectors and alleged Iraqi mistreatment of Kurds and of certain Shiite Arabs in the Tigris River swamps. Of course, what the British really want is the destruction of the Middle East, giving the entire area back to the sand, the scorpions, and the locusts, for reasons of British geopolitics and race hatred. Because of the insane economic embargo, Iraq has lost an estimated $55 billion in oil revenues, much of which would have been invested in development projects, many of them with foreign contractors, including American ones. Until the Gulf War, Iraq was the biggest single purchaser of U.S. rice exports, often buying a quarter of the entire American crop and supporting the economy of many a parish down in Louisiana. The U.N. sanctions exempt food, so it is our own government that seems to be blocking food sales to Iraq. Contracts with General Motors, Westinghouse, John Deere, and others have been kept frozen. One result of these sanctions is that inside Iraq, it is virtually impossible to obtain vital medicines and pharmaceuticals. This has been the direct cause of an increase in the mortality rate in Iraq by a factor of 13. And this in turn is translated into 1 million needless deaths as a result of the UN embargo. 1 million deaths of children, women, and men. A generation is growing up under these economic sanctions. A generation that has been given good reason to believe that the Western countries, and above all our own, want to kill every Iraqi. Think for a moment of the harvest of hatred and extremism this will produce a little further down the road. This is exactly what the British and the UN bureaucrats want, with the perspective that a ruined Iraq will make a permanent peace settlement in the Middle East simply impossible. This is yet another example of a Bush-era policy that has been functioning on automatic pilot despite the coming of the Clinton administration, and it is high time for a change. The national interest requires the end of all economic sanctions and embargoes against Iraq and a policy shift towards peace through economic development and cooperation, including U.S. development assistance to Iraq. If Warren Christopher and Madeleine Albright at the UN insist on tailing the London policy, they should be replaced. In retrospect, we also have to understand what the Gulf War was. It was an infernal gambit of British geopolitics, and London's characteristic response to German reunification and the collapse of the communist regimes in Eastern Europe and the USSR. The British and their friends had given Saddam Hussein secret but lying assurances that they would have no objection to a move into Kuwait. This is an old British trick. This is how they started the Korean War, and how they later started the Malvinas or Falkland War in 1982. After Saddam had made his move, the British quickly declared that the Western countries had to go to war. In Washington, Bush had for days been watching the satellite pictures of the Hammurabi Division of Iraq's Republican Guard being arrayed along the Kuwait border, but Bush said nothing. A few days after the Iraqi occupation, British Prime Minister Thatcher, the Snatcher, flew in on her broom and met with Bush in Aspen, Colorado. The British press later joked that Thatcher had performed an emergency backbone implant on Bush to stiffen his resolve. Thatcher demanded a large-scale war against Iraq to restore the slave-holding emir, who is, of course, a British puppet. For Thatcher, it was a question of preserving the dominion of the Anglo-Saxon race. And that, of course, is something that Bush believes in very much. So Bush quickly jumped onto Thatcher's broom. Later, during Desert Storm, the Western bombing followed a bomb-now, die-later strategy, concentrating on water systems, bridges, and other civilian infrastructure. 200,000 combat sorties brought death to about 500,000 Iraqis. Much of Iraq was reduced to pre-industrial rubble. Now, 3.5 years later, if we look back at that war, can anyone in their right mind assert that any United States interest was served? To the contrary, Bush's thyroid storm adventure destroyed whatever stability there had been in the old world of the 1980s. Lebanon was sacrificed to Syria as a price for Assad's support. The Middle East and Indian Ocean economies were ruined. This was, for example, when Somalia descended into chaos with terrible long-term consequences. And just as the Gulf War was ending, Serbian aggression began with British sponsorship in the crumbling Yugoslavia. As a result of the Gulf War, a new 30 years war has begun to devastate the earth. The historical verdict on Thatcher and Bush is thus not a matter for the history books, but rather for a Nuremberg war crimes tribunal under the heading of international conspiracy to unleash aggressive war and genocide. For the current administration, the lesson is that it is time to take Middle East policy off autopilot and time to implement the LaRouche Oasis Plan for Middle East economic development. Now, today we're joined in the studio by Anton Chaitkin, who has just returned from a lecture tour in Iraq, during which time he came in contact with government officials, Ba'ath Party leaders, university professors, students, medical professionals, and others. At the end of his visit, Tony appeared on a popular talk show on Iraqi television. Tony Chaitkin is well known to LaRouche Connection viewers as an eminent historian, the author of Treason in America, and the co-author with yours truly of the unauthorized biography of George Bush. Tony is also a leading political activist who has spent time in jail after he was arrested at a protest against the statue of Albert Pike of the Ku Klux Klan here in Washington, D.C. So I would like to welcome Tony Chaitkin to the LaRouche Connection. And I'd like to ask you, first of all, tell us about your trip to Iraq. When did you go? How long did you stay? What did you do?
Well, we were there for the first week of May. Drove across the desert from Amman, Jordan, and we spoke to groups of people that had been assembled for us in universities and private organizations and parts of the government. I was really stunned by the spirit of the people there, despite the horrors of bombing and its aftermath, which is worse than the bombing. Their spirit is tremendous. And I was also struck by the fact that they were not hungry for revenge against the United States. This was a very moving experience for me. I'd never been, of course, there, and this is, with its 5,000 years of history, a lot different than being here in the United States. I think that most Americans don't have any conception of Iraq as a country, what was done to them, or most of all, the fact that it's still being done to Iraq by our country at this very moment.
Okay, now let's focus on what is still being done. The economic sanctions, the economic embargo. Can you just describe what this is?
Well, first of all, the United States Navy is deployed in that region to stop ships going towards Iraq or going towards Jordan and so forth, in the area of the Persian Gulf, the Red Sea, and so forth. They have been stopping ships to make sure that nothing gets through that's not supposed to go through there. The oil, which is Iraq's main source of revenue, is frozen. Iraq cannot sell its oil on the world market without agreeing to give up its national sovereignty. Iraq has at least the second largest supply of oil in the world. So it's a very wealthy country, but cannot earn its normal revenues. It has about $5 billion or so cash in foreign banks. Those accounts are frozen. So here is a rich country that is still in many ways wealthy despite this savage bombing in the Gulf War, but it is penniless in effect and subject to starvation and massive death inside the country because of this embargo. There is no specific prohibition against many of the things that are in effect blocked and forcefully blocked.
Probably food or medicine would be the interesting thing.
Well, for example, there is no specific law or decree, whether by the UN or by the US, against the import of medicine. Mm-hmm. Various tactics that have been taken, including especially the freezing of the cash and the inability of the country to spend anything on the world market, has blocked the shipment of medicine in there. There are other things that are being done in very tricky ways to bring about a slow death to the children and medical patients in that country.
Okay, and what is the alleged legal basis for these sanctions? What do they go back to?
The most important thing there is that it's changed, mm-hmm. dramatically changed. The first demand of the Bush administration was for the Iraqi army to get out of Kuwait.
In return for lifting the sanctions?
Yeah, the sanctions went into effect before Bush attacked Iraq. So the Iraqi army withdrew basically during the war. And even though the army was out of there, the sanctions did not leave. There were demands to have Iraq permit UN weapons inspectors to come into Iraq. That occurred.
Mr. K.
That occurred. There were demands to allow the UN to do other things, to allow the UN to go and inspect the Kurds, to have a no-fly zone and to have the Iraqis cooperate with that, where the Iraqis were not allowed to have airplanes in the air in certain areas of the country. Not only did they agree to that, or they permit that, but in fact today, Iraq is not allowed to have any aircraft of any type flying. And this is a deathly situation in a modern country.
No civilian aircraft.
There are no airplanes flying in the nation of Iraq. This is done by force and by subterfuge. The aircraft of the country were taken out of the country at the early stages of the war. They were not allowed back in there, and pressure was applied to World Airlines not to go in. Mm-hmm. And so even though there's no specific legal prohibition against it, by de facto machinations of the UN and the Bush administration, and still on autopilot under Clinton, you cannot get into the nation of Iraq except by auto, crossing 600 miles of desert from Jordan. If you're an old person or a young person who's suffering from some disease, you have to get out, maybe go to a foreign country for medical treatment because of the disastrous medical situation in Iraq, you're going to die. You can't make it across that desert. But these things are imposed by the various bureaucracies and by the various private agencies that have manipulated the United Nations and the areas of the U.S. government to bring this about.
So the sanctions have been there since August of 1990, pretty much. But the alleged basis, the rationale, why they're kept in place, is constantly shifting. And every time the Iraqis fulfill one set of conditions, they're then confronted with another set of even more degrading conditions.
And it gets more and more vague because the cry that Saddam Hussein and the Iraqi leadership were a brutal dictatorship, eliminating the rights of the people in Iraq, wasn't true at the time. This new Hitler idea was promoted by George Bush. It's become something of a sick joke because Iraq is a military state, like all the states in the Middle East. There is an element of dictatorship there. But the fact is that the people more and more support Saddam Hussein as a result of the bombing, as a result of the punishment inflicted by this UN coalition. And now Saddam Hussein is revered as a virtual saint inside Iraq as a result of George Bush and his policy.
So the demonization of Saddam Hussein has backfired.
It's backfired in a way that makes George Bush the object of scorn and contempt by the people there who have vowed to die before they would give up their right to have their own government.
Now, in the course of your visit, you got to talk to government officials, but also to academic audiences of professors, students, and people like this. Can you give us a brief kind of description of what it's like to talk to an Iraqi official and what kind of thinking and mentality they have, and maybe compare that to academics, students, younger people?
Well, the Iraqi government people and political activists that we spoke to are extremely knowledgeable about world affairs. This is a country that has had a very jealously guarded independence in the world over the past several decades since their revolution against the British-backed monarch in the 60s. They are extremely well-versed in the subtleties of British and Russian and American politics, much more so than in a lot of other places. There is a certain amount of third worldism, which we did confront in some of the university audiences, and also among the economists, which was somewhat interesting. But the people in the schools, in the universities where we spoke.
And which were those?
I lectured at Mustansiriya University, along with Muriel Mirak Weisbach, who was invited with me. She's with the EIR in Europe. We spoke also at the University of Mosul in the north, and at Baghdad University, again back in the capital. We also had a wonderful seminar with the Union of Arab Historians, and this involved some of the most knowledgeable and wonderfully literate people I've ever met, archaeologists and historians. We spoke at the Association of Iraqi Economists, and we were involved in a roundtable seminar at the Foreign Service Institute of the Foreign Affairs Ministry. This was a real knockdown, drag-out discussion with no holds barred about U.S. policy, what the U.S. Government is and isn't. And we were really invited there to speak very frankly about why the West is crucial for the development of Iraq and the Third World, why the Western heritage of the Renaissance and of Western science is precious, and conversely, what happened to the United States? How did this American Revolution, which the Iraqis are very favorable to, as against Britain, how this went sour in terms of an oligarchy? What is this oligarchy? What are the American oligarchs? What is Rockefeller? What is Rothschild? What is Morgan? Why did the United States do this? This is the question that was asked by people not only in the universities and political people, but on the street, in the mosque, in other places where we were constantly. Why? Why are they trying to kill us?
What level of awareness do they have of the British and the sort of the machinations, the mind of all this?
Per capita, I'd say that the Iraqis are more aware of what the British are up to in the world than any other country. If the U.S. citizen who fought a revolution in his ancestry against the British had the same level of awareness, we'd be a lot better off. Their experience in Iraq with their revolution was more recent. What they are not totally perhaps aware of in the university, in the street, is the way that British geopolitics uses the prejudices, the hatreds, the fears of each nation, each nationality against those, against the prejudices and fears and so forth of its neighbor, and plays people off against each other. They know that in general. But for example, we were called upon to describe graphically and in detail how British military and Masonic officials organized Zionism in the Middle East, and for what purpose, how that was done, how some of the same institutions back in Britain organized the Hitler regime. As two examples of a British racist policy using national hatred and national foibles and national weaknesses to get a continual crisis in a region. This is something that they want to learn about because they see this enacted before their eyes in the Middle East and in Europe today also.
Then what would you say is the Iraqi view of Lyndon LaRouche?
Well, of course, in a sense, they were playing the LaRouche card to invite us there. It was our Bush book, which identifies LaRouche as our associate and mentor, which is circulated throughout Iraq. The Executive Intelligence Review is on the shelves of every intellectual in the country. The leadership and the intellectual people in the country, the political people, are really thrilled to see that there is a competent fighting force in terms of ideas in the West that has really spread throughout the world. And this is their identification of Lyndon LaRouche. One of the government people that we spoke with was most enthusiastic and excited about the latest EIR that he had on the table in front of him when we came into his office. And he said, you know, I completely agree with LaRouche's forecast of the destruction of this Western financial system, that people, many of the academics don't understand this. And he was.
And how do they see the coming crash of the derivative structures?
Well, one thing is that the you have to understand Iraq is so proud of its ancient heritage, the Temple of Hatra that they built, which we saw out in the middle of nowhere. You see this 2,000-year-old structure built by Arabs, a Roman and Greek temple out there, the 4,000-year-old Assyrian culture. And the Caliphate of Baghdad in the year 900, the tremendous richness and massive length of time that this country has been in existence and that they can reflect upon as a cultural thing, gives them the scope of thinking to be able to appreciate this Western criminal clique, Thatcher, Kissinger, Bush, as a temporary evil. It's a kind of a mistake in God's time over the, you know, if you're looking at things in the space of thousands of years. So yes, this thing is wrecked because it hasn't done what in both the Bible and the Quran is required, which is investment in real production. It's based on usury and it's destroyed itself. They see this as not only inevitable but something that now is happening in this particular period of a few years, which causes a political crisis, the destruction of this financial junk bond and so forth regime is something that they are basing their whole policy on.
And they have George Bush on the lobby of the main hotel?
When you go into the Al Rashid Hotel, you see a display of their views on the American political situation. This is a hotel we stayed at, and it was bombed during the war. I don't even like to call it a war because there wasn't two sides in the war. Iraq didn't fight the United States. The United States, Bush's forces, destroyed Iraq. They also bombed this hotel. A woman employee was killed, other people were injured. And after they rebuilt the hotel, they put a mosaic tile on the floor at the entrance, which has a quite accurate picture of George Bush, and it says, "Bush is criminal," in English and Arabic. Notice that they didn't say, "The U.S. is criminal," or "The West is criminal," or "The U.S. is a great Satan," because they don't believe that. They don't. They are emphatic that they want good relations with the United States, and they are flabbergasted and puzzled about why we're killing their children.
Now, before we leave the details of your trip, maybe we could try just a little bit to focus on the humanitarian emergency. Because of the lack of medicine, people are dying for no reason. And I think you came close to individual lives where people had lost relatives, again, because medicine was not there and other kinds of medical procedures are being interrupted. Can you tell us about that?
The most dramatic part of our visit from the standpoint of the embargo was actually up in Mosul, in northern Iraq. When we were at the famous Jonah Mosque, we encountered...
Now, Jonah Mosque.
This is a mosque which recently has been refurbished. It's beautiful. But it's a very ancient structure where the prophet Jonah, who was spit out by the whale, is buried. He has
so
a
this
tomb
is where
there.
He got out of the whale.
Well, yes, that's Mosul is ancient Nineveh that he went up there to reform, and they revere him in the Muslim faith as a saint, as a prophet. And so he's buried in a beautiful silver tomb there. On the steps of this mosque, we encountered beautiful children. I took some pictures of them, and parents were there and saw that we were interacting with the children. They said, "Why are your people trying to kill us? And please convey back to the Americans that no matter what happens, we are not going to die as a people." And so we were asking them, what are the effects of this embargo? And the fact is that many families with small children do not have enough to eat. Iraq only has only can produce 70% of its food requirements internally. And with the struggle to get things across the border, like from Turkey, a few vegetables and so forth, they have a terrible situation. They have death among children, especially from weaker people. We went to the University of Mosul, spoke with the dean of the medical college there, and he said, "We are not now graduating doctors here anymore, because we cannot give them patients to practice with, because people are not admitted as ordinary patients to the hospitals. They do not have bandages, they don't have syringes, they don't have antibiotics. And rather than have them come in here to die, they stay home." This is compounded by the fact that they cannot even get the latest knowledge that might give them some clues as to how to get around this terrifying situation. If a doctor in the United States sends a medical booklet like the Proceedings of the Pediatrics Society to his colleague in Iraq, the United States Postal Service will seize it and stop it from going through the mail. Now, there's, as far as I know, there is no specific law, maybe some UN commentary or something brought this about.
Even the UN always said that food and medical supplies were exempted.
It's all illegal. It's being done by subterfuge and force. And the American medical profession, in general, hasn't said anything about this. But this is causing death to the children, to the older people, to the weaker people of Iraq. The startling thing there is that at the same time as they have this horrifying situation, they have rebuilt the infrastructure in that country since the bombings. They built a beautiful tower, communications tower. They name it Saddam Tower. That's the defiance against the United States, against the West. Maybe 800, 900 feet tall, right in Baghdad, beautifully painted. One of the huge towers of the Baghdad power plant was blown up in the war. When they rebuilt it, they put the national colors in a spiral on the things, as if to say, "Go ahead and bomb us. We're gonna rebuild." Almost every public structure that was destroyed during the war has been rebuilt. We went to a exhibit at the Ministry of Trade in Baghdad and interviewed the trade minister. Gave us a graphic account with the pictures and models that they have there of the bombing and targeting of food infrastructure. smart bombs wrecking a shopping center, blowing up a food warehouse.
The famous factory for infant formula.
Yes, they targeted every place that had to do with the distribution to the public of food. They even bombed farms. They bombed crops in the field. This went on after the war was over. And almost every one of these public structures has been rebuilt.
And that was done pretty much with indigenous means.
Indigenous means without foreign assistance. They pointed out again and again to us that this cost the U.S. jobs, that they would have normally had U.S. engineering and workers come in there and help them rebuild, and it would have been billions of dollars worth of contracts for the United States that the U.S. government has forbidden.
Certainly, out of all of the bombing atrocities, the one that attracted most attention at the time was the Al Amariya bomb shelter, which I believe you visited.
Yes. This was actually the third time that that Muriel Mirach Weisbach was there. It was my first visit to the country. And previously, she had gone to render assistance to some of the survivors of this inferno. She got some children out of the country to Germany and the United States for medical care.
This was under the auspices of the Committee to Save the Children of
That's
Iraq.
That's right. But this shelter, built by Scandinavian firm, one of the several built by Scandinavian companies, was targeted deliberately by bombs. We saw the hole in the top of the shelter through the reinforced concrete that the smart bomb had made when it came into the shelter. This blast caused the door to the shelter to be slammed shut. Some of the people were blown out the door and actually survived. And the Iraqis have turned this into a memorial and museum for the approximately 1,200 people that died inside there. And there are pictures on the walls of victims. In one case, an entire family had its history recorded on a chart that was up there, the father and the mother and the three daughters who were all engineers, graduate engineers working, and another daughter who's still a student and her children, all killed in this bomb shelter at once. We encountered a woman there dressed in black, not a very old woman, who says she will spend the rest of her life in this shelter. She lost six children, were killed in this shelter, and six other members of her family. And so she's going to stay there for the rest of her life to explain to visitors about this crime. There, we could see on the wall of the shelter imprints of hands and other body parts, very similar to the way human body parts were impressed on the walls at Hiroshima by the blast of the atomic bomb.
The shadows
of the people.
Let's maybe take a look now at the political framework of all this. The United Nations sanctions, as we established before, are still in effect, and I take it that they're open-ended. There's no time limit on them. They're just going to go on and on.
The United Nations is clearly close to abandoning the sanctions, and they are simply being held in there by the power of British and allied to the British lobbying within the U.S. government. The U.S. government has really the say-so over this. If the United States decides to change, get away from the Bush policy, the sanctions are over in a minute because the rest of the world considers this thing to be an embarrassment and to be an atrocity. There have been already following our visit, I think we played a small role in this. There were delegations from Germany at a high level, from China, and from other countries, eager to do business with Iraq to get back into the oil business and other construction businesses. This is all frozen, however, as long as this insane punitive policy continues in effect.
Now, from the British point of view, why is this important to keep going, these sanctions? What do the British get out of this?
The most important thing, I think, is what the Iraqis themselves identified. And that is that they believe they were targeted because they, above all countries in the Middle East, are committed to using their oil revenues to develop high technology industry and infrastructure. They not only built things in their own country of the most modern technological sort, but also devoted their resources to developing other countries, especially Arab countries. So as long as Iraq has that point of view and is in operation as a modern country, the whole character of the Middle East is pointed in a way that British geopolitics cannot stand, which is the development of national power of what the Iraqis speak of as the Arab nation.
And at the time that this all started, Iraq was clearly the leading Arab state. They had an exemplary policy on the status of women. They had, I believe, a law that said that you had to learn how to read and write, and if you didn't know, the government would teach you how. They had, of course, a religious tolerance that was far greater than, for example, places like Saudi Arabia, where all other religions other than Islam are simply outlawed.
You see this in many ways. In when we were in Mosul, we went to the Church of St. George, which is a Catholic church. It's their own version of that.
But with an Iraqi
Chaldean,
rite.
The Chaldean rite, yeah. But this church celebrated a double wedding while we were there, two couples, in the face of all this troubles of the country and the death rate being so high. And there were 200 people at this wedding. Two-thirds of them were Muslims. Until 1948, and the complication of Zionism came into the Middle East picture, they had a very large Jewish community also in this in Iraq. So they had a policy, and they still have a policy of absolute ecumenical existence. There are three groups in terms of religions in the government, which is the Shiites, the Sunnis, and the Christians. Tariq Aziz, the famous former foreign minister and minister to the United Nations, is a Christian. He recently met with the Pope. The same thing goes for the status of women. We had a wonderful dinner one night at the Oil Club. It's a little bit different establishment than I suppose the Oil Club in New York or London might be, or Houston. I've never been to those places. But I imagine it looks a little different than this, but it was the Oil Club. And one of the young women that was there was the president of a university, a women's college, actually. And she was fiercely defending and promoting the role of women in the world and basing her defense of this modern role of women on what the practice of Iraq has been for quite a long time, which is not promoting something contrary to Islam, but promoting something in accord with a higher conception of it. And I think in many countries like Malaysia, as well as Iraq, but I think Iraq is the best example of it, people that we're in touch with in the LaRouche movement have a really a high-level understanding of what the best possible connotation of Islam is and its role in the advancement of the world. And it's there in the sciences, in political life, in engineering and other fields that women play a very important role.
Maybe we can get back to this in a minute in the context of the Cairo conference in the UN, but what would you say then the role of Iraq in the region is in terms of development, maybe also with an eye on the Middle East peace accords?
Yeah, in their official discussion of the peace process, the Iraqis are opposed to what has been presented to them as the discussions between Israel and, say, Jordan or the PLO. Of course, they don't have a lot to do with it because they're completely isolated by this embargo and war against them. So these are simply, in a certain way, academic discussions. But the reality, the underlying reality, is that no peace in the Middle East is possible without a central role for Iraq. Iraq will be the provider of the technological edge to the Arab side of things in the region. And they are so committed to good relations with the West and with the rest of the world that if Iraq is permitted to fulfill that destiny of its development of oil, nuclear power, the space program, and so forth, there's no way you're going to have a war in that region, because the interweaving of economic and scientific and cultural initiatives will just preclude any thought of a war. Israel knows this. The most advanced leadership in Israel is fully aware of this, and we have indications that there are, in fact, discussions going on with Iraq.
And how about other states in the region, Turkey, Jordan, even Syria? What do they think about these sanctions? What do they think about the whole thing? How do the Iraqis see them?
Well, different governments, of course, played more or less rotten roles in this war. Everybody was put in a position of agreeing to get some bribe to go along with the war, even if they didn't really want to get the bribe, because it was such a disgusting and ultimately destructive thing for their own countries. Jordan was absolutely forced to stand by Saddam Hussein and the Iraqis because the people of Jordan were so adamant that this atrocity not be permitted. Right now, every country in that region wants these sanctions to be lifted. And those countries that were the basis for the war, in a certain way, like Saudi Arabia, are not calling for vengeance or attacks against Iraq either, because it's such a destabilizing force in that region, these sanctions.
So Iran, Turkey, they would like to see this normalized.
There is the basis right now for normal relations, for example, between Iraq and Iran, which, according to Kissinger and Thatcher types of thinkers, is a terrible thing. It's better to have a war. That way you keep the balance of power, which is the same piece of insanity that we had with Zbigniew Brzezinski and the Carter regime, when we said we'll favor the mullahs because they're religious and the Russians are atheists. This is this high-level strategic thinking of these brain-dead British.
Okay, now maybe we can look at the overall picture. We're now on the eve of the Cairo conference, the so-called UN International Conference on Population and Development, and we see this Iraqi story as a case study of what the UN does, because in effect they are the ones who are doing it. Mm-hmm. How would you, for example, use Iraq, the example of Iraq, to help people understand what's actually planned for Cairo, that the UN is actually looking for genocide of this type?
Well, Iraq was targeted along with Panama. People forget that because it was a smaller war. This is the opening gun of the population war of the global regime, the United Nations and the globalists, against the Third World, against Eastern Europe, and wherever else they feel that they need to keep in a state of disrepair and destruction. Iraq's leadership insists that the globalists, that's their term for the people who run the United Nations, the old British Empire crowd.
The one world supranationalists.
In other words, these Iraqis are not communists and they're not State Department liberals. They know exactly what they're talking about in this area. And they insist, rightly, and they wanted to get details from us, that this crowd at the United Nations is out to destroy civilization, and that the population policy of the United Nations and the policy of war, where the UN goes and supervises a war, either carries it out directly or supervises and watches it take place and covertly supplies the ammunition for it, that this is the unified UN policy. I think of any country that I know, Iraq has really some of the fewest illusions about this population question. They don't get involved in debates very much about the supposed arguments which in universities really all over the world, actually even in Iraq, you have British economics. But the arguments about dwindling resources and so forth, they don't get involved in that carrying capacity because they know how foolish such a notion is, that it depends entirely on what policy a national government carries out. If you increase the scientific prowess and power of a country, all of a sudden that country has more resources because you've defined things that weren't resources yesterday as resources today. We had a funny interchange with a couple of economists in the Baghdad seminar we had with them. They were complaining that their government doesn't understand economics. And one of them said to me at the end of the seminar that the government is foolishly carrying out this huge infrastructure development program, even after the war. They don't understand economics because monetary theory teaches us that a country like this could only absorb a 2% per year increase in technology. And I said, well, thank God they don't understand economics. Because this is British economics, which is simply discarded by people in any role as a nation builder, any leadership that has the task before them of creating the ability of a people to survive and thrive, has to completely discard professional economics of the 20th century because it's bankrupt. It's a fraud. It's a consumer fraud. It's a form of brainwashing, and it's not competent, and they know it, and they always reach out for 19th century and earlier economic ideas of the Russians, mm-hmm. the Germans, and the Americans. That's one of the reasons we were invited there.
But in the administration of the country, this Malthusianism is not the thing.
There's no illusions about what the UN is all about. Of course, they had whatever illusions they might have had in the past were eliminated when they saw the UN inspectors, who supposedly were there to look for nuclear weapons programs, operating day after day as a provocatory force to try to get the war started again, to try to reduce the sovereignty of the country, every possible trick again and again and again to the point of ludicrous exhaustion. And so anybody that has on their own territory these blue helmets from the UN operating as a force of rats and skunks and spiders knows that this is not a group of scientists and professionals who are talking about real economics.
Okay, now suppose we want to take the autopilot and turn it off. Now suppose for a second that you're looking over President Clinton's shoulder. What should he do?
Well, he has to go back to finish some unfinished business. Back in 1912, there was a railroad project from Berlin to Baghdad that was part of the possibility in the world at that time of construction of railroads all across Eurasia to the Pacific and down into the Middle East and Africa. The Germans were building this line into Iraq, and the British saw this as a cause for war, one of the many causes in their view.
I think actually 1899 was when the British seized Kuwait. Even though it was theoretically still part of the Ottoman Empire, they de facto detached it to make sure that that railroad could never get to the water at the Persian Gulf.
One of the crucial causes of war in the Middle East today is the simple fact that there is no infrastructure that unites the region. And there's no infrastructure that unites the region with Europe except for telephones. And that's about it. So the first task of an American president who wants to be an American president and who may survive the Bush and British attack against him would be to say Iraq and the Middle East are a crucial part of our survival. If they make it, we're going to make it. If they don't, we're finished. They have to be included in the bargain for the development of Europe. They have to play a role with us in the development of the Middle East and Africa. There has to be in the Middle East, above any region in the world, a very deep, layered, civilizing process going on with transportation networks, with new cities built. We've got to rebuild Lebanon. We've got to rebuild the entire national life of the states in that region. And I think that it's possible for Clinton, especially as we provide a certain amount of guidance for him on these issues, to see the human rights issue above everything else as depending on economic development and national sovereignty, that you will not have in Iraq or in Jordan, which is under total siege all the time. You pass King Hussein's palace in Amman, mm-hmm. Jordan, and it's surrounded by walls and machine gun towers. Every country in the Middle East is under constant threat that their government will be overthrown, their leaders will be assassinated, and their nation will be broken up into little feudal kingdoms at war. This is the life of these countries. Under those circumstances, human rights are impossible. What's needed there is peace, and the way to get peace is to reach the kind of agreements to begin with that are going to build up the power to produce, the power to survive, and the connection between those regions on a permanent basis. Give up the idea of breaking up and overthrowing these countries, of breaking them into pieces, which is an old British theme there.
So give up the Bernard Lewis plan, get the British intelligence and the non-governmental organizations out of the Middle East.
You have to call the Kurds in Iraq and Turkey and other places where they are in that region and tell them, boys, we've got a map of the Middle East. This is the final map. We're not going to change the map. We're going to take some measures of accommodation, as Iraq has already done inside Iraq. Mm-hmm. We need to do that by agreement, by outside help to build up the living standards in these areas, especially where these national minorities. But we've got to agree, finally, that war is not going to be our policy. That war in the Middle East is the established policy of the British Empire, and that's got to be brought to an end.
Okay, now we just have a few minutes. Part of the problem with the sanctions and the continuing agony in Iraq is the fact that despite the fact that George Bush has been ousted from the presidency in the election, there is still this persistent power of a Bush-Thatcher machine, which now includes the depravity of the father being carried forward by the sons, as people in Florida and Texas know, and also people in Virginia looking at Bush's stooge Oliver North running for the Senate. Now, you've been looking also at the question of the depravity of the new generation of the brood. So tell us something in conclusion about the brood.
Well, the wages of sin may be death, but right now they're quite profitable for, say, George W. Bush, the son who's running for governor of Texas. But it may very soon be blowing up in his face, along with Neil and the others who have been involved in various forms of theft. George W. Bush, the main owner of the Texas Rangers baseball team, is surrounded by professional gamblers. The majority of his income comes from his partnership with Richard Rainwater, casino owner, who's his co-owner of the Rangers team and several other enterprises. Other partners of Bush, of Junior, are looking to build gambling casinos in addition to their baseball holdings. Now, this all centers on a little group that helped George Bush get away with a crime, which is that when his father first, as president, first began putting the wheels in motion for the war in the Middle East, he may not have had a specific target, but he wanted to have a war in the Middle East. When his father broke off the U.S. dialogue with the PLO back in 1990, 2 days after that act, George Jr. secretly sold his shares in the Harkin Energy Corporation, which is a Texas and Persian Gulf-based oil exploration operation. He sold his shares. He did not report it to the Securities and Exchange Commission as required by law, because that would have blown the war. And so it turned out that he didn't have a problem from the Securities and Exchange Commission. One reason may have been that his lawyer, who engineered the deal with these gamblers to buy the baseball team, Mr. Doty, James Doty of Baker & Botts, was at that time the general counsel for the Securities and Exchange Commission.
Now, it sounds like we have the statutory basis for naming a special prosecutor right away, in sharp contrast
to the fact is that the Bush family and every member of it that I've been able to study, particularly George W. running for governor of Texas, Jeb Bush running for governor of Florida, and Neil Bush back there in Silverado and Colorado, these people have shared with their father in theft on a scale that has never been known in American politics, along with deals to help the communist and other enemies of the United States, particularly in the realm of drug pushing that's gotten back
to this
country.
Okay, I'm afraid we've run out of time. I'd like to thank Anton Chaitkin very much for being our guest once again on the LaRouche Connection, and we'll see you next time.